In every city and in the suburbs, on the streets and in the parks, in the homes where we live, crime lurks, waiting to make you the next statistic. Every 2 seconds, the FBI tells us a purse is snatched, a house is burglarized, a car is stolen. And every 17 seconds, someone just like you is a victim of violent crime. Murder, rape, stabbing, every 17 seconds. Could you do that? How can you protect yourself and your family and avoid being the next statistic of crime? At last, self-defense expert Dave Pearson is here to teach us how to be safe and aware when our world is getting more dangerous to live in every day. The rate of violent crime in the U.S. is now worse than in any other industrialized country. Since 1990, twice as many Americans have been murdered than were killed in the Vietnam War. Will crime touch your life? Are you already counting the cost?
Stop!
What are you going
Hold
to do
right
about
there.
It?
Give me your money. Your money. Your money.
Join us now for a special that could literally save your life. Safe and Sound. How to protect yourself in a world full of crime.
Okay, everybody, hi. Well, let's see. That was a karate thing that I did with a bunch of bad guys coming at us. But, you know, those were people that were karate students of mine. They knew how to move just right. And those moves were all prearranged. Nobody got hurt. People say, oh, man, you really must have broke that guy or something. It was just all put together. I thought it was a really great thing for, wouldn't that be a good commercial for like wearing a suit and tie and do karate? But anyway, that was the karate fight scene. It did look real. And the things that you see here today, I want you to remember not to try them at home. Because you can get hurt. I've had some kids go to karate day, they're really good with the bricks, and I got home and I tried to, I had a fire log in the back of my house and I tried to break it, it wouldn't break. Did I do something wrong? Yes. So don't try karate when you see stuff here, especially the weapons. I do have Glenn with me today. He's my son. He's a black belt. And Dawn here. Now Dawn, the girls were training her for when she starts to date. What do you think? Yeah. And Christian karate, people say, what in the world? How can you be a minister and do Christian karate? Is that like beat the guy up and invite him to church? How does that work? And we don't do that. It's not like that. But you know, I tell people I would count myself a failure if I could train my son to black belt and he could take on 5 guys physically. But how about if he couldn't handle one temptation? Like lying, cheating, stealing. So we're going to talk about keeping up our guard today. That's my theme when we talk about karate and using it as a tool to reach boys and girls and how to live for the Lord Jesus. I love that one song that we sang about how to taste and see that the Lord is good. And I reminded of the fruits of the Spirit in our life. And they come in 8 delicious flavors. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith. You talk about the fruits of the Spirit that we should show because that's how Jesus was when he related to people. But now I have a lot of crowd participation today, And we're going to have kids come up, and when you come up here, I'm going to have different ones come up who are sitting still making good choices. I forgot to mention that Toby is here. We use Toby. That is a real safety man, he's called. And Toby is for people who take, especially women who are alone. They take a long trip somewhere, and they'll put Toby in the front seat of the car, and it makes it look like some big strapping 6-foot guy sitting in the front seat. And we've done that before. We've gone through the highway. We put him in the front seat with his head turned like this, in the seat reclining. It looks like a real person in the car. And that's what he's been designed for by a Christian lady, a friend of mine, who makes these guys. And we've had a lot of fun with them through these years. Okay, today he's got Pastor Phil's uniform on. Doesn't that look sharp on it? Okay, now, getting right into our karate program, I want to remind you young people, there's a way to keep up your guard for the Lord Jesus, and this is how it works. You can't shoot the devil, you can't stab the devil, you can't blow the devil up, you can't even do a karate trick on him, a kick or a punch, can you? There's only one weapon that we use against the devil, and that's God's Word. We're going to be sharing a lot of Bible verses today, and that's the only weapon that gets sharper with use. God's Word is described to us as the sword of the Spirit, and it gets sharper as you use it, and you hide God's Word in your heart that you might not sin against Him. So I want us to do a little exercise together, talking about keeping up our guard for the Lord Jesus. It's a spiritual guard. It's a type of guard that you can't see. So the next time you feel a little disrespectful or disobedient to mom and dad, you remember that verse in the Bible that says, oh, children, obey your parents. Honor your father and mother. You know those. And that's a way to keep up your guard. So let's do this. Bible reading and prayer. Let's do that together. Bible reading and prayer. Now let me take away prayer in my life and just read the Bible all the time. That's not how to be, because that's not balanced. I mean, just pray all the time. Take away the Bible. That's not balanced. In my Christian karate patch, we have a patch that says, balanced living. That's the Christian life. That sums up the whole Christian life. You need to have a balanced approach to life in Christ. So Bible reading and prayer, you need to have both. What if I don't read the Bible or pray? Now, do I have any guard at all? No wonder sometimes through the week, if we don't pray, we get impatient, we get angry, we talk back because we're not keeping up a spiritual guard. So remember, boys and girls, how's it go? Bible reading and prayer. That's how to do that. With all that in mind, I'm going to use these lessons. These things here are blockers. They're foam rubber. You can't get hurt, but they make a lot of noise. It's okay, honey. It's all right. You okay? You scared? Now, I'm going to have somebody come up here who's brave. This guy right here in the black shirt, come on over. That's right. Girls, can I hit the boys hard?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Come on over. Step up here. Step up here. What's your name?
Evan.
Evan? I always shake the hands of people that I hit. Come on over. All right. Now, Evan, I'm going to knock your block. No, I'm just kidding. Evan, you got to keep up your guard like this. Put your right arm up. Mm-hmm. And block nice and strong. Nice and strong. Over here. That's right. This one. And this one. Faster. Look at you. Go. And this one. And one of these. One of these. Over here. Boom. Let's give him a hand. That was a great job. Wow. Let me have a young lady come up here in the white top. Come on over. All right. Is that Jennifer? Come on over. Okay. She's one of my karate students. Good to see you. Yeah. Okay, watch this. Now here comes some temptations. Let's call some of the temptations. Ready? Lying. She blocked it. Cheating. She blocked it. How about, here comes a double whammy. Disrespectful to mom and dad. Nice. And then overhead, I'm going to mess up your hair. Ready? Here we go. How about skip church? Well, that was wonderful. Here we go. A little faster because you're so good. Let's give her a hand. Way to go. All right, I think, Dawn, you come on over here. Dawn is like the queen of the blockers. And I'll let you see how she does. All right, karate stance. Let's step over here, honey, so they can see the look on your face when you get hit. Okay, ready? Here we go. Ooh, give her a hand. Wow. Thank you, Dawn. Now, Dawn, she's going to do a kata, an orange belt kata. So those that might know this form, if you're in my karate class, make sure she does it right. Here she goes, nice and loud, honey. Hey, give her a hand. Nice job. Wow. Okay, let me have one of those target pads right there. Here we go. That one, Let me see. I'm going to have someone come up here and slap this thing. Now, boys, I heard girls know how to slap. Right, girls? You know how to slap? Let me see. Hi, honey. What's your name? What's that? Come on over, sweetie. Come on over. I'm going to let you slap this. Look at her. Isn't she precious? Okay, you ready? And you're going to go and slap this thing. Slap it. Oh, you got it. Thank you. That was something else. She knows how to slap. Yeah, I can tell she's got older brothers and sisters. Hey, let me have this guy right here. Come on over. Okay, I'm going to have you slap like this. Listen. The big slap, okay? Wait a minute. I got to put my little seatbelt on here. Because it went flying out of my hand last time. Okay, big slap. That's better. Okay, give me a hand. All right. And did you know that you could possibly miss this target if you had your eyes closed? Some people go like this. And their eyes closed. Some people turn their head when they swing. Like this and close their eyes. You'll miss it for sure. In life, we need to keep our focus on who? On God, that's right. And I want you to remember this one phrase, in a little bit we'll hear about it. But when I was younger, I learned at a very young age to glance at my problems. I know they're there, but to gaze on the Lord Jesus, to keep my focus on Him. I know sometimes when troubles come, when things happen in your life, it's easy to go like this and stare at your problems and glance at God.
Ooh, I got this test coming up in school. I'm going to be a miserable failure. I don't know what I'm going to do about this test. I'm getting all worried about it. And then you keep your eyes on your test and your problem and not even think about praying and asking God to help you. My kids, I have them say a silent prayer right in school. Lord, help me to do my best at this test. In Jesus' name, amen.
But you need to focus on the Lord and remember that He can help you no matter what because of the Bible that we have. That shares the truth. Okay. We talked about this. This is the Bible verse that I have. And if you can read this, maybe you can help me read this. James 4:7. Submit yourself, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. That's how to resist the devil. Surrendering yourself to the Lord first and committing your life to Him and yielding to His control. That's how to have a balanced approach to life in Christ. James 4:7. Okay, now, I have a shield. This shield you put on, if I had you come up here, you put the shield on like this, and you hold on to it, and you put this in front of your stomach and your chest, and you're like this, in the top of your head. So, Glenn, let me have one of those swords. I'm going to show you something. This is like the sword. See how nice it is? Okay, now when you do this, I'm not going to let you hit hard, but you're going to have a friend come up. And you're going to do this with your friend. Now, let me tell you about this. This is the sword of the Spirit and the shield of faith. And you need to have your shield up to quench the fiery darts of the devil. And we're talking about living the victorious Christian life in Christ. And the way to do that is to make sure you have your sword and you have your shield. So let me have a couple people come up. Two girls first. Let me see. This young lady right here in the back, come on over. Thank you, Glenn. Okay, so get that there, and I want you to pick a friend of yours. Who would you like to have come up? Take a look. Okay, come on, girls, come on. That's right. Hey, the The sword of the Spirit. Here we go. Shield of faith. Put your stuff on. It's your right hand. Did you put this in your left hand? That's correct, yeah. Mm-hmm. Girls, you just take it easy. Don't hit it in the face. Come on over. Okay, no biting, scratching, pulling each other's hair. Alright, here we go. Gotta bow first, out of respect, bow. Good, they always look at each other's eyes. Never just bow to the carpet. Nice carpet. Okay? Always keep your eye on your opponent. Do a karate stance, girls. Go like this. Hi-ya! Mm-hmm. Now don't hurt each other, but mess each other's hair up. Ready? Let's go. Go. Oh, oh. Use your shield. Use your shield. Come this way. Make her go back. That's right. Yeah. Her feet. Make her dance. That's it. That's right. Time. Thank you. Let's give them both a hand. Nice. Okay. We have two boys now. Let's see here. This guy in the red shirt. Come on, Matthew. And this guy over here in the red shirt. Yeah. Come on up, guys. Help him put the stuff on there, Glenn. Okay, come on. Okay, and these guys are going to bow to each other. Bow. So like this. Uh-huh. Go. Get him, get him. Get him. Let me help you.
Get
out! His feet. All right, use your shield. Whoa, whoa. Come on, look top of the head. Look top of the head.
Oh.
Time. Let's give these guys a hand. I think they look good. Great going. Okay. Now, Glenn, you get your size out here. I'm going to let Glenn do something with weapons, and he'll show you what a nice weapon, kata, a form looks like. Thank you, boys. You did wonderful. Okay, these are called sais, and the sai is used against a sword. I have my sword here today. You don't want to come close to this thing. I tell you what, in the Christian life, we talk about the Bible being our weapon, right? The only weapon that gets sharper with use. Now, could I cut anything with this covering on, the sheath? The sheath is there. I can't cut anything, right? I can't cut anything. So, the blade needs to be exposed and open. Now it can cut. Just like God's Word, you need to have it open. What happens when you leave a book on the shelf, the Bible on the shelf? What happens to it? It gets all dusty. And I've heard this to be true. Maybe you've seen someone like this. A dusty Bible leads to a dirty life. And you need to have Bible practice that brings Bible power into your life. And that's how to do that. Use the Word of God. Now watch this. The sword comes along and the sai is there to stop that blade right there. That's what those little hooks are for. He moves it out of the way and then he uses the other one and gives me a little poke. That's what it's for. Okay, Glenn, I'm going to let you do that. I'm going to let you do a little kata there.
I'm going to be doing the green belt kata.
Yeah! 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 Yeah!
Oh, give me a hand. Thank you, Glenn. Very nice. Okay. This weapon here I have to show you real quick. This is called the Gurkha knife, and it's sort of shaped like a boomerang. You see that sort of strange shape? And that was for the shape of, you cut down things in the, and this isn't for branches, it was for other kinds of limbs. That's why it was designed that way. And then, now you have this, and it's really sharp, and then you have these little tiny ones that are inside the sheath. And those little tiny ones were like a calling card. They would wipe out the person with the big blade, and they have that calling card. They would stick that in their arm or something, and then be able to say, that's who did it, the Gurkha warrior. And that's what those little knives are for. But you know what? When you do this, I do a little warm-up with that, and the weapons are what they used against the enemy, when the enemy came. But what's our weapon against the devil? Good boy. Give him a hand. That was nice. The sword of the Spirit. In order for me to live in the life of the Lord Jesus, I need to have a balance. Now, this nunchucks, if I don't have the proper balance, I'm going to hurt myself. And by the way, that's why I always get in front of people, I use rubber nunchucks, okay? But you do two at the same time. You better have the proper balance. And if you don't have the proper balance, I could go like this. Or like that. So you don't want to do that. You want to go full hard.
Balance out your body. Come up with figure eights.
There. All right. You can clap if you'd like to. That's fine. Yeah. I'm going to have somebody come up here and try to have the balance we talked about. This girl right here in the green sweater, come on over. Let's see how you do with the nunchucks. I hope you don't get numb. All right, here we go. Follow me. Hold it at the top. Hold it at the top. Right there. Okay, ready? Follow me. Forward. Okay, forward. Uh-huh. Backwards. Good. Now, can you try the figure eight? Oh, go slow like this. Go slow. That's almost, you got it. Almost had it. You're doing it. She's got it. Good going. Now, go forward now. Go forward like this. That's backwards. Go forward. There you go. And then try to stop it like this. Hey, she stopped it. Give her a hand. Nice job. Okay. All right. Let's see. This guy in the yellow. Paul, come on over here. That's right. You guys are doing great today. Here, hold it at the top. I'm going to let you do two at the same time. Put them out here and stay away from me. All right, ready? Go backwards. Nice. Go forward. Okay? Now try to stop it. Okay, go forward and try to stop it, Paul. You can do it. Hey, give him a hand. Let's go. Way to go. Well, look at this here. I have a nice lesson about this here. You know what this is, probably some of you. It's a light. Before I knew the Lord Jesus, I wasn't shining. But when I accepted the Lord Jesus as my Savior, I came alive. And we're supposed to be shining for the Lord Jesus, right? But did you know what can break that fellowship? What can break that fellowship with God? Yes. Sin. Give him another hand. Sin. Wow, that's really sharp. Listen, sin can make my testimony or my shining go, oops. I know some Christians, they're like this on Sunday. Well, I'm in church, I pray, I sing, but I go to the mall, or I get with my friends in the neighborhood, I'm like this. But you need to have an open witness about the Lord Jesus and tell the world that Jesus saves. What's that one Bible verse? Let's all do it together. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him, not perish, but have everlasting life. Did you know that you could put your name in there? It's a very personal thing that the Lord Jesus did for you. That God the Father loved you so much that he sent his only Son. Watch this. Let me see. What's your first name? Raker. For God so loved Raker that he gave his only begotten Son, that if Raker believed in him, Raker would have everlasting life. And you can put your name in there. I know Karate Dave. When I accepted the Lord at 7 years old, I could put my name in there. You can put your name in there. It's a beautiful thing. When you accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, he gives you a brand new life. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become brand new. How many have ever witnessed to somebody? How many have ever invited a friend to church? That's shining for the Lord. Exactly right. So that's my lesson about shining for God. And make sure that you stay clean, clean hands and a pure heart before the Lord by getting with him regularly and asking him to help you and forgive you if you've done things that you need to have straightened up in your life as well. Okay, now, let me have some of those Bible verses because we want to use these today to remind us how to live the Christian life. Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. And then over here it says, John 15:5, for without me you can do how much? Nothing. So you need to Surrender your life to Him and give Him control of your life. Here's another one, Romans 12:21. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. And I remember when I was younger on the playground, kids would be mean and hateful sometimes with what they say. And I remember one boy came to me and he said, "Hey, dummy, come here." And I went, "Huh? You're talking to me?" And I answered him and I came over to him. "Listen, it's not what people call you, it's what you answer to. If you just leave it off and not even respond to that kind of thing, maybe you'd be better off. You know what? Pray for that young person as well that talks unkind." One time my son was really close to me. I was like from here to where he is now. He was like 7 years old, and this little boy came over to him and said, "I hate you." Now, I'm his dad. What's going to happen now? Should I go over there and scold that little boy? Don't talk to my son like that. Who do you think you are? No. I stood there and I said, "Lord," I whispered a little prayer for my son. Help him to respond God's way. And he stood there without skipping a beat, and he said to that boy that said, "I hate you," he said, "Hey, where'd you get those cool-looking gym shoes?" And the kid went, "Huh? I just slammed you, now you're complimenting me?" And he shrugged his shoulders and walked off. He did a Bible principle. It says here, don't be overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. And then there's another Bible verse that says, a soft word turns away anger. And my son complimented the boy, and he was defenseless. He didn't know what to do. He was expecting my son to go, "What was that again? You said, say that again, I dare you. I'll punch your lights out." Right? You would probably think that way. "I'll pull your hair or something." Don't be overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. Amen. Here's one. Romans 5:8. For God commended his love toward us while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Acts 16:31. And they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house." So wonderful Bible verses. We did the John 3:16 there, and we shared that one. For God so loved you that if you believe in him, you will have everlasting life. And that's a wonderful promise that we can claim. Okay, at this time, I'm going to let Glenn and Dawn sit down. And thank you, Glenn. We're going to be able to continue on with our program. We have about maybe another few minutes. And I just want to share with you a little bit about why we're here. Karate Dave was adopted. I don't know if you know someone who was adopted. Anybody you know who was adopted? How many here were adopted by your parents? You know someone who was adopted back here? These guys were adopted? And I was brought home. My parents were thrilled. They were able to get a child adopted, and they couldn't have any children biologically, so then they got me, and they brought me home, and everything was wonderful. But you know, my mom and dad, they lived in the Chicago area, and I lived in the south side of Chicago, in Homewood, and my parents brought me home. I never did meet my mom and dad, the ones that had me. Never met them. And years later, my mom, I was 4 years old, my mom, they had a lot of things. My dad had a really nice car, they had a beautiful home, my dad was a contractor builder. And then they had a cabin cruiser boat. And they went on the lake. My mom loved to entertain, and my mom went on the lake with her friends. And while she was out there, the boat and everyone on it disappeared. My mom was never found again. Her friends showed up missing. They couldn't find them. It was big news. I still have the newspaper articles. I heard it was on the TV. I heard it was on the radio because I was 4 years old. I don't remember all that. They even put a submarine in the lake to try to find my mom and her friends. They never found my mom. She just vanished. That was hard for a four-year-old. What happened to mommy? My mom's dad was a preacher, my grandfather. And he was in Beverly, Illinois, not too far from here, and he was preaching in his church, and he was constantly looking in the audience for his little baby girl, Rose, because he thought maybe she bumped her head, she might have forgot, she had amnesia, maybe she'll show up through my doors at church, and she never came. That was a sad thing. I can't imagine my daughter just suddenly disappearing. But that's what my mom had happen with those who loved her very much. I was 4 years old. I didn't understand what happened to my mom. All I knew was she was gone. Years later, my dad started to drink and make some poor choices, and he took me with him to the bars, and I was like 6, 7 years old at that time, and he would just give me to total strangers at the bar. Wouldn't you like to take this boy home? He's a good little boy, he's well behaved, and you can have him for a couple weeks. Take him for a month, you can have him. And I would go to a bar, and I would be scared to think that maybe who am I going to go home with today? Maybe my dad is going to give me away to someone else today. I wonder who it's going to be. Some nice people? Or maybe are they drinking and getting drunk too? I remember one lady, all I remember about her is that she showed me how to make a bed. That's all I remember about her. One other lady, she made me, one other place I lived, she fixed me a nice breakfast. That's all I remember about these people. One day my dad was at the bar and I'd never seen him like this before. He was really drunk, out of his mind. When you get alcoholism going in your system, you do things that you don't even realize. It's so awful. That's why, listen, I found the best side of a bar where you drink, the best side of a tavern or a bar is on the outside, amen? And there's no high like the Most High in Jesus Christ. But one day my dad was there, and he always put his hand out like this to me, and it meant like acceptance. It meant, I'm glad you're with me, son. Give me a handshake here at the bar. Come on, be a man. So I put my little hand, and listen, I was smaller than I am now, back when I was 7. And my dad put his big, my dad's Swedish, and he's a big contractor, builder, carpenter, big muscles, and he was a big man. And he took my little hand, 7 years old, and seemed like he squeezed my hand like this, as hard as he could have seemed like. And I instantly fell on my knees in pain because it hurt. Ever had your hand squeezed really hard? But my dad did that. And tears just came. I just started to cry because of the pain. Now, I wasn't the type to yell out and say, "Hey, Dad, leave me alone. What are you doing? That hurts." I didn't do that. My dad saw I was getting emotional, so he threw my hand away. And I got back on that bar stool, and I was crying. I was wiping the tears away, embarrassed. People started to look at us now. So I was looking at the TV in the corner, and I was embarrassed, and my dad took that as rejection, because I just turned around, and I was crying, and he tapped me on the shoulder, and I turned around as an obedient child to see what he wanted, and I looked at him like this, and he gave me a full fist right in the face. Boom! Like this. I went flying off that bar stool, instant bloody nose laying there. I remember the bar stool falling down, and the bartender lady, oh, she ran around fast. I thought, oh, good, she's going to help me. She picked up the bar stool and left me there. My dad gave me a hanky, and he threw a hanky at me. I'm ashamed that you're my son. The bartender lady said, "Hey, listen, you're making a scene here, Glenn. You better leave." So I'm holding my nose, and I'm holding my dad, and I'm helping him out to the car. He can't even walk straight. Now we're going to drive home. He would go down the up ramps on the highway. He would go down one-way streets and sideswipe cars and keep moving without stopping. We didn't have an airbag in our car. I was holding onto that headrest really tight, driving down the road with my dad, holding my nose. That was a sad story. But I remember at 7 years old, I said, "Lord Jesus, I know if I accepted you, I accept you in my heart, that you can forgive me from all my sins. And I know if you come into my heart, then I'll have a heavenly Father that loves me unconditionally, and that you won't give me away to people at the bar. You won't hit me around and beat me up. That you love me, you accept me." Like Pastor Phil said earlier, he embraces you in his everlasting arms, and he loves you. He'll protect you. He'll be your deliverer. Please help me, Lord. And that day I got gloriously saved. And then I had this wonderful desire to pray for my dad. So I prayed for him a lot. When he would leave me at night, he wouldn't get home until 1, 2 o'clock in the morning. And I remember kneeling next to his bed, praying, "Lord Jesus, please help my daddy to stop drinking. Please help him to live for you. And please protect us, because I'm scared." One lady I lived with, she took me to her place, and she lived in an active part of town. Now today you can't say bad neighborhood. So you have to say active neighborhood. I mean, the kind of neighborhood that you would go 3 blocks without leaving the scene of a crime. Do you know what I mean? But there I was, and this lady said, "Hey, Dave, don't go outside alone. And by the way, keep the blinds closed." I said, "Okay." I don't know if it was that night or a few visits after that, but remember she had this big fight on the phone with her boyfriend. Yeah, back and forth, cursing, swearing, and she slammed the phone down. Oh, man, he said he's going to come over here and kill me. And I went, what? Yeah, he's coming over right now. So sure enough, you hear the brakes outside the car, outside the window. Come flying up the stairs. I could hear the metal of the gun on the door. Boom, boom, boom. Jump me in there. I'm going to kill you. And then the lady said, you can't come in here and kill me. I've got a little boy in here. I went, shh, what are you doing? Shut up. And I was scared to think that any second that door was going to open up and burst open, and I was going to get pierced with a bullet. But God protected me. Somebody in the hallway said, we're calling the cops. Get out of here. And the guy ran off. That was scary. So I had a long time there without being with my dad. And then my dad couldn't keep me anymore. So he said, you know what, son? I've got a residential home, a place where other boys and girls go, because you're 10 years old and you can't even spell your name or count to 100 at 10. You need help. You're LD, learning disability. And so I went into this place where they gave us all medication to keep us slow, like this, really slow. And I remember the other kids that were there, they would rock themselves asleep like this at night and finally fall over out of exhaustion. I'm going, what am I doing here? God, please help me. I asked one of the counselors there, there was a hippie counselor with the long hair and smoking pot and stuff, and I said, can you tell me, is there a Lord Jesus Christ? I remember I got saved. He says, there's no such thing as a God, you're a God. And I believed him, and I cried myself to sleep that night thinking that I was all alone. Now listen, whenever you're tempted to do something wrong, the devil's ace trumped for you to believe is that you're all alone. What are you going to do now, hotshot? You call yourself a Christian? Try to get out of this one. And he wants to make you feel you're alone. But God said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And it's just, I remember right after that, my godly aunt and uncle who lived in Midlothian, Illinois, they took me in. For the first time I heard gospel preaching. For the first time they showed me unconditional love. And they prayed over me. And I started to learn how to read at 12, 13 years old for the first time. And I went years later, I graduated only 1 year behind my graduating class. I should have graduated in 1979, but I graduated in 1980, only 1 year behind when I started school at 13. That was the Lord that did that. But you know what? I remember that LD thing, the Lord, that it stood for learning disability. For me, I turned it around. The Lord and Dave. And that helped me go through my difficult times in life. My dad called me years later and he said, Dave, I've stopped drinking. I love the Lord Jesus. I'm in a gospel preaching church, an Assembly of God church in Florida. I want you to know I need to see you personally, face to face, to apologize. Would you please come? I need to ask for forgiveness for how I treated you. And I said, sure, Dad. And I flew down there to Florida. And while I was there in Florida, he was there. He felt so ashamed. I'm sorry, Dave. I didn't do better for you as a son. I said, Dad, I forgive you. Do you think I could have not forgiven my dad? Do you think I could have ended up hating him? No way, Dad. You did some awful things to me. You're out of my life forever. I didn't do that because God had already had a hold of my heart, and I knew that God could do great things. You know what I did that day? Remember I told you that he put his hand out to hurt me? I got to put my hand across the table in forgiveness and love. But I had a chance, young people, to go to my dad and say, Dad, I want to let you know something. Remember when you punched me and you left me, you abandoned me, you shoved me off to other people? I forgive you. I love you. I got to put my hand across that table and I shook his hand out of love and forgiveness. And I don't know when I'm going to get married someday, but if I ever get married, I'm going to name my son after you because I love you. He says, why would you do that? I was the black sheep of the family. No one really liked me. And I said, because God called me his own. I got married. Very first year of our marriage, Glenn was born. My son, named after my dad. The very next year, my daughter, Dawn, was born. And she's Sunrise herself. And she's a beautiful Christian girl that loves the Lord. Both of my kids are Christians. And just what a thrill to see them grow up in the Lord. My wife was not feeling well, and she made some poor choices and walked away from the Lord, and then she took off, and she left a few times and took the kids with her, and one last time she left, she tried to take my children's lives. in an awful accident. She was going to try to take them in their life. My daughter woke up with a rope around her neck. And she said, "Mom, what are you trying to do?" "It's okay, honey. We're going to go to heaven now." And my daughter said, "God's not done using us yet. I think God wants to do some wonderful things through me. Please don't do this, Mom." They immediately put my two kids in foster care in the government, and they put my wife in a special hospital, a mental institution. And she was there. She called me up, and she said, "Dave, can you please come and get me? I'm sorry for I lost the kids. Please forgive me." And I got to offer my hand of forgiveness again to my wife, and I said, "Sweetheart, I'm here. Let's make things right." And she got home, and while she was home, trying to get her kids back, she had tongue cancer of the tongue. And then she died. Now I'm by myself with my kids still in foster care in Pennsylvania, and I couldn't get them back. Through a lot of prayer and through a lot of asking God for help, being a father to the fatherless, my God in heaven brought my kids back. And we just now been back together a year and a half or so. And Glenn and Dawn, you come up here real quick. I got Glenn to share something before I break these bricks. And Dawn, you say, "Well, Karate Dave, you had a rough childhood. My mom disappeared, my dad died of cancer when I was 24, and my wife just died recently." Dawn, come over here, honey, and share. Here's the microphone. Share what Nahum 1:7 means to you.
There's a Bible verse, Nahum 1:7. "The Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble, and he knoweth them that trust him." Through my situation with losing my mother, I really took that verse to heart, and I'm so glad that the Lord brought me through that awful experience.
The Lord showed me this really cool way to look at WWJD. How many have heard of that saying before? Great. Okay, this is a new way you can look at it. WWJD stands for "What Would Jesus Do?" That backwards is DJWW, and that stands for "The Devil Just Won't Win." Isn't that great? We've used that through my losing my mother and being taken away from my dad and now being back with him, and we're just so happy about that.
Thank you, Glenn and Dawn. Let's give them a hand. Thank you. Very good. Now I'm going to break these bricks. I went over a little bit today, but I just want to let you know, when I break these bricks, I'm thinking in my mind of all the things God brought me through that were hard and even painful. Somebody says, "Does it hurt when you put your hand through all that stuff?" Yeah, it does hurt a little bit. And then after that, it goes away. But you know what? When you go through anything that's a difficult, hard thing, it's not joyful. But I got a remarkable thing that was revolutionary for me. When you go through a hard time, it's possible for God to give you peace or comfort without taking away the trouble. Because he's like that. He puts his everlasting arms around you and love to you. Maybe in your life right now, there's some hard things that you don't understand. Or maybe they'll come in the future, and I know they will. But God can help you go through anything if you keep your focus on him. Don't let anything get you down except on your knees in prayer. Ask the Lord. It says in Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, "Trust the Lord with all of your heart. Lean not unto your own understanding. In all of your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path." Now when I do this, I'm going to go over it several times. And when I'm ready, I'm going to let out a big yell. They're going to break. And then we're going to close in prayer. Okay? Here we go. Okay, let's close in prayer. You can clap this time. Oh, okay. Somebody asked me, "What's that feel like, Karate Dave, when you break those bricks? Does it hurt your hand?" Your hand's numb at first, and hopefully that goes away. So that's how I do that. All right, we're going to close in prayer. Everybody, bow your head and close your eyes. I'm going to ask you a couple questions before we close. And so, you know, Karate Dave, some of these things you told me, I was listening, and I want to give my life over to the Lord and let him have full control of my life. I haven't been praying like I should. I've been sort of angry. I've been talking back to mom and dad a little bit. I'm not very nice at school, on the playground, or in gym class. But I want to be a better Christian. Or I want to be a Christian that really shines for God? Is there someone like that here? Raise your hand. I'm going to point you out. Say, pray for me, Karate Dale. I really want to make sure that I'm living for Jesus.
I want to ask God's blessing and protection on your life because you have a desire in your heart to live for Jesus. Amen. All over. Put your hands down.
Put your hands down. Let me ask you this last question. Maybe someone here today, and you say, you know what? I've heard about becoming a Christian, and I'd like to know more about that. And I'd like to see Pastor Phil or one of the pastors here and talk about how I can know for sure from God's Word to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. I want to become a Christian today. Is there someone like that here today with a slipped up hand? I want to settle that today. I know I've not been sure, but I want to make sure today. Is there anybody here with these few? Anybody else? Okay, let's close in prayer. Lord God, thank you so much for this opportunity, and I thank you for the Stone Church and the wonderful witness that it is here with these children. And Lord, I pray that you'd bless them and keep them safe. And Lord, I pray that you'd be with those Christians who raise their hand, that they want to be more of a witness for you, an open witness. And I pray for those who raise their hand for salvation, God, that today would be the day of salvation for them. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Thank you.
Thank you.